বিচার একটু দোকান তাকে দিই পাকরা ওখানে চাই হুম মাও স্যার ஹலோ Good afternoon to everyone. I am very happy to participate in this series of webinar to commemorate Wildlife Week celebration from October 2nd to October 7th. In this regard, that Snake Park is doing excellent work the last few days and giving various talk, lectures, and other things. Today, Snake Park requested me to give a lecture on the ecological role of snakes and in our environment. In fact, I would like to introduce myself. I'm Dr. V. Kalayarasan, herpetologist, sometime worked as director of Chennai Snake Park. I did my PhD on Community College of Reptiles in Scrubbing Forest in Chennai. I last 20 years and associating with Snake Park, particularly in research site. With this small introduction, I would like to go to the subject. This very big, very common subject, it need not it need not require any kind of introduction to the subject. Because everybody knows all living play a significant role. Significant role in food chain. And food. So most of us are very well aware that is what's the ecological function of snakes in the environment. So this one. That we can give a little more on this. My specialization is Community Ecology of Reptiles. How these reptiles are sharing their ecological niche, that is food niche, that is temporal niche and spatial niche. Mm-hmm. Things. What's interestingly, people knows that rat, snake and cobra feeds on cobra. If the two animals feeds on the same prey, mostly rats, then how its coexistence in the same habitat, that is very interesting.
Otherwise eating rat now, still our rat is not extinct.
Interestingly, these both species found all over India, that most, all habitats, but it still coexist together, having that trophic, that is called more feeds on rats. And partly some frogs, but having their niche, that is very interesting. Though it's having that food, but it's sharing their time. That is, the general biologist must be knowing that is what is nocturnal, what is diurnal, what is crepuscular. In this case of it mostly acts.
Snake parks here most.
And that actively hunting its prey, rats. Dawn and dusk. Whereas the rat snakes mostly hunt its prey, that is either rats or frogs during a daytime, but is diurnal. Okay. All snakes partition their resources depending either trophic niche or temporal niche or spatial niche, whatever the niche they are participating, dividing each other, they are coexist in the environment for many decades, many millions of years. That's what people knows how these symmetrical species coexist together. That is very interesting things. That's what I did my research. Then so I am coming to this general introduction about snakes.
possible for him?
See, generally I wanted to give you a small introduction about snakes, that snakes are evolved from lizards about 135 million years back.
No, 1 million years back.
Subsequently in the world, we have about 2,750 species of snakes, which almost 10% of the species found in India, that is almost 275 species are described in India. Very interesting that the Indian feature, that is a very longest snakes of the world, that is regulated python found in India. Similarly, longest poisonous snakes known as king cobra also found in India. The world's smallest snakes, blind snakes, also found in India. So largest, longest, and generally, I wanted to give a small introduction about the general biology of reptiles. I mean snakes. Animals generally we classifying in two categories. One is cold-blooded animals, another thing is warm-blooded animals. All snakes are cold-blooded animals. That means, what do you mean by cold-blooded animals? You see, the blood is very chill, like ice, nothing like that. What is called cold-blooded is that a group of organism can change their body temperature depending upon the ambient temperature, that is external temperature. That's what it's called, cold-blooded animal. All snakes are cold-blooded animals. Another interesting feature is snakes have forked tongue. Why it's having a tongue? Is it for taste or something else? But it is very interesting that it's an organism meant for a smell, but why it has a forked tongue? The smell is playing a major role in detecting its prey, for which when there is a slender and very small tongues means it's not able to get more what accuracy of that smell of the prey. But so if it's a forked tongue, that the basal surface area is more, in which attract a better part of smell. That's what is having forked smell. And as all of us are aware, there is no external ear or middle ears that the animal cannot hear that noise. Then very interesting, all snakes are exclusively carnivorous. It won't take a vegetarian. Then snake can not chew their food. It may mammals or other animals, it will not chew the food, it swallow the food as a whole. Then very interesting that snakes are shed their skin periodically, because snakes always grows. So whenever there is a growth, then there should be a need for a shedding of skin, that the exudacy is happening. So it's frequently it's shedded skin. Then most of the snake hunt prey by their sight. I said there is no external or middle ears, but there is acute vision is reported in all animal, all snakes. That's that using its sight, this animal used to hunt the prey. And most of the snakes are oviparous. That means they used to give baby through eggs, lay eggs. Then after incubation, the baby used to come. Then some of them are oviparous. Some of them are viviparous, like green snake, boas are oviparous, then all vipers are viviparous. Then very interesting, how this animal communicate to each other for mating or anything else? It's communicating through pheromones, that very interesting. Through chemical signal, it's identifying their opposite sex. Next. So before going to the role, I thought of giving a small introduction about the classification of snakes for a layman purpose. Snakes can be classified into two groups, that is venomous snakes and non-venomous snakes. Venomous snakes are king cobra, cobras, crate, vipers, pit vipers, coral snakes, and sea snakes. These most celebrated snakes, spectral cobra, it's found all over India. It's one of the commonest venomous snakes found in human habitations. That the second thing is common crate. These are also very common, found all over India. These are the snakes claim most of the snake bite cases in India because it is exclusively nocturnal. It easily enter into the human habitation. Most of the time this bite happening when the person while sleeping or other activities. That's what's happened during night hours. Then this is one of the other modern viperine snakes called Russell's viper. And this is also very common, found all over India. This is one of the tiny snakes that is grow about 15 to 30 centimeter in size. In Rajasthan, it's, you can see that snakes at a larger size. It also one of the venomous snakes. But arid zone, this animal killing most of the human being there while during their agriculture practices. And I am coming to that other group of snakes called non-venomous snakes. This group have that very interesting species like blind snakes, boas, pythons, uropodids, rat snakes, kukri, tree snakes, and wood snakes, keelbacks, cat snakes, and wire, whip snakes. And this is one of the common snakes found all over India in the forest and scrub jungle area, that is Indian rock python. Just sometime introduction, I was mentioning about this Indian rat snake. That Indian rat snake is very, very common non-venomous snakes occupying all habitats, all terrains in India, which mostly feeds on rats and frogs. Wherever there is water bodies or paddy field, when you are going for agriculture activities, you can encounter the species, very common. This is one of the common snakes, that is wood snake. It is looked like a mimic of crate. A crate, you would have seen that is cut very, and there you can see that silvery bands in that black skin. Here you can see the silvery band bands in what you call brown color. But what people often get confused, this also crate. It is a non-venomous, harmless snakes. It's not a crate. But interestingly, this species found wherever there is a piles of stones or rocky crevices where crate also lives together. That sometimes crates also take this as a feed. That's what both snakes found in same habitat. This is one of the beautiful snakes called common ring snakes. This is also very common non-venomous snakes. This actually I was telling that is some of the snakes are burrowing in nature. And I will come to the later about this role of every group of species. These are not the common sand boa found in agricultural fields. This is one other sand boa called Eric's Joni, that is red sand boa. This is also playing major role in agriculture areas. Then this is one of the common water snake that is called checkered keelback. All water bodies and paddy fields, you could see these snakes very common. This is a striped keelback, Ambisima striata. This also keelback snakes. Very interesting story about this one is if you in villages, if you kill this one animal, one snake, that another nine animal will follow it. Because it's nothing but already I was mentioning these snakes communicate through the chemical signal. And that animals frightened or try to kill it, then it will emit these pheromones that it attract other opposite sex. That's what that is. Very common phenomena. Even as a child, I noticed this when I kill this animal snakes, other animals immediately follow. That's what this very interesting story about it. This is other kind of keelback, more restricted western gods, green keelback. And this also mostly feeds on. I was telling that is there a group of snakes can be classified as arboreal species. This is one of the arboreal snakes. Everybody knows these common vine snakes. You can find wherever there is a bushy vegetation available, you can see these snakes very commonly. Then this is other common tree snake, common branch, but this is also very common in all jungles. I was mentioning there is some pit vipers which are not known as a big four, but it's also equally venomous. But a lot of studies going on whether this can kill a human being or not. That's still research is happening now. Actually, I am coming to the subject that is, what is the role of snakes? Generally, all animals have aesthetic and ethical values, and all living organisms playing a major role in balancing an ecosystem and controlling agriculture pests and medicinal values. First of all, I would like to share a few aesthetic and ethical values. You see that all religion reaches only peace and love to every organisms. For example, prey and predator relationship of rats and snakes is being demonstrated by Lord Muruga, Lord Ganesha. Similarly, snakes versus eagle, that relationship is demonstrated by Lord Venkateshwara. Similarly, that is Bible also preaching the importance of snakes. Then, similarly, that all religions have some kind of myths or stories, either scientifically backed up or non-scientific manners, has worshipped. Sometimes it's scattered. Sometimes it's we felt it's very dangerous to human being. All these things it's felt all whenever that human being evolved the earth from Adam and Eve's days. So it's have a lot of ethical values. Then what is ecological balance? I wanted to mention it. When I was telling to that non-venomous snakes or venomous snakes, you can classify the group of species depending upon the habitat. What you call these tree snakes, like bronzeback tree snakes or green snakes, mostly feeds on tree lizards, Greek geckos, by which way it's controlling prey population. Then when you're coming for a burrowing snakes, that is called sand boas. These are the only species can go into the burrows by using its head and tail and go into the burrows and hunting the rats and play major role in controlling rat population this agriculture field. And also it's loosen its soil by the way it's doing earthworms business. That's what you call this aerating inside that soil particles is being happening because the two species. Then when you are talking about frogs, water snakes, most of the water snakes feeds on frogs and small fishes, which way they are managing that aquatic ecosystem in balance. Then terrestrial snakes are predating all varieties of organism like frogs, toads, rats, and geckos, other species, by which it's playing major role in controlling that and managing that terrestrial ecosystem. Then when you're talking about venomous snakes, very interestingly, that venomous snakes may play a major role in controlling rodent populations. And that all venomous snakes are found very close to human habitation because wherever there are rats, there will be snakes. So such a way that more rats means it will ultimately leads to epidemic disease plague and all. This were being controlled by the snakes only. In fact, I was sharing to various platforms that during all my lectures, urbanization is taking very high percentage in Tamil Nadu. Now almost 65% of the state is urbanized. The urbanization is ultimately taken toll of all the snake populations. That's what people are nowadays saying, that is snake being encountered, snake being rescued and all. Even metro city like Chennai, almost thousands of snake being rescued and removed, and we are living inside this very close forest. What will ultimately lead the frog pass? What will happen? This rat population going to be increased. Once the rat population is going to be increased, all urban cities going to have a problem like hepatitis B as well as plague and other things. So that is, if a snake is there, it can kill a venomous snakes, it can kill a person or two. But if a plague or communal disease is spread out by rats, then whole community wiped out. That's what I'm very serious about these things. People should have thought of before rescuing and releasing snakes. You should identify whether this is necessary or not. Particularly, even I'm looking at various YouTube's channel and other medias. People are in the name of rescuing snakes. They are rescuing, catching the snakes very close to fringes of agriculture areas or forest areas. They are saying there is an animal being rescued. This is not a rescue at all. This is indirectly you are going to help the rodent population, which ultimately taken toll of not only our brains or other things. It will spread all communal disease. That's the during the pandemic is corona time. We should again very cautious about role of all living organisms in the ecosystem. That's what the snakes playing major role in controlling rodents. By which way this communal disease will be stopped? Otherwise, that continue indiscriminate elimination of snakes in the name of rescuing that will harm the ecosystem. That's the most important things I wanted to mention in this webinar. Please, my fellow colleagues, do the research and whether the rescue operation is very needed or not. If it's very needed, where it is required. Unless it's required, we need not catch snakes or rescue the snakes and release in the nearby jungles. Please, the last 50 years, snakes are playing major role in educating the public and bringing awareness about snake park, this identification of snakes, venomous snakes, and what is the treatment for snake bite and all. Unless you popularizing the subject, that people will continuously indiscriminately remove the snakes, it ultimately will harm to that ecosystem, which will affect the human being also. That's what I reiterated again this subject. The snake park last 50 years, what I could see that in and around snake Chennai city, the awareness is very high level. That's what the residents now try to live with this non-venomous snake, like rat snake, checkered keelback, or wood snakes coming to their place. They are not ultimately complying to any authority. They are leaving the snakes just their their backyard. Only the venomous snakes mean people are calling either snake park or forest upon they are rescuing it. Please, all the state examine that whether it's the name of rescuing snake, if we should collect the snakes and remove it is good or not. Then I am coming to the next interesting subject, controlling agriculture pests. We do not know, we are not ascertained what is that capability of this group of animals controlling the agriculture pest. Because the food chain, most of the insects are being fed by either frogs or lizards. The lizards in turn have a biggest role in controlling in pest. They in this food chain, this population of frog as well as lizards are being controlled by snakes. That's what this ecological balance is well maintained in agriculture system. Unless the snakes are not there, then agriculture ecosystem will be degraded. And another thing is very interesting, that is we should know what is the medicinal values of this snake. Snake venom being used in time immemorial for various kind of treatment in Siddha as well as Ayurvedic. Now allopathy also now using that snake that is called what we called enzymes derived out of the snake venom being used for post-surgery and pre-surgery level. And now people are doing a lot of research on how we can use that enzymes for curing cancer. So it's a well-established science that people are now doing a lot of research on medicinal values. To extract the venom for medicinal purposes mandate, unless you have a stock of venomous snakes in your backyard or in your field, then you may not able to use that byproduct of the snake that is called venom. Then what's simply this may not be relevant, but you should know that is how that Government of India is protecting all snakes as per Wildlife Act. That is most only few snakes are comes on Schedule 1, which is highly protected. That is Indian rock python, reticulated python, egg-eating snakes. And other snakes, Indian rat snakes, Ollie keelback, checkered keelback, king cobra, Russell swiper, dark faced rat snakes are protected under Schedule 2. Why this comes under Schedule 2 is very interesting. I wanted to explain. It's not ascertained by that scientific data available the population density of that particular species in particular area. But it's ascertained in 1972, there was a blanket ban on snake skin exports, that which then the people identified these Schedule 2 species are vulnerable, highly exploited for snakes and skin industries. Based on that subject, I mean, input only they put in the schedule 2. It's not ascertained through scientific studies. That's what we need. Again, we should revisit and reclassify that status of snakes as per Wildlife Act. Other than these schedule 1 and 2, most of the snakes are comes under schedule 4. In fact, I feel this some snakes under schedule 4 are highly vulnerable and then endangered than the schedule 2. That's what this, as I was mentioned again earlier, that is 275 species were reported in the country. Out of 275 species, we do not know what are the species are today exist or what they exist, what you call endangered or extinguished from the world. Particularly, I wanted to mention this based on our experience. There is one group of snakes called Europeltids. It's having about 35 species described by Galgans and my mentor and guru, Dr. M. E. Rajendran, somewhere 80s. They described more than 35 species. All of them are restricted in Western Ghats and part of Sri Lanka. But today we do not know whether what's happened to the species, whether all 35 species exist or any species became extinct due to the habitat degradation and the excess use of pesticide in tea and coffee estate. We do not know. So that's why, similarly, there is another group of little known snakes called Typhlophidae. All Typhlops, we do not know what is the present status. That is the case, then we should not give more importance to the Schedule 2 or Schedule 1 animal. People are very frequently encountering a species of, rat snake, checkered killback, olive killback and all. But what's happening now, that unknown species require a lot of research, and we should revisit the Wildlife Act according to the species distribution availability. See, when I am coming to the last slide, that is what are the threats? I was mentioning earlier that this particular group of Europeltids and Typhlops facing a severe threat due to the habitat destruction like landsliding and other aspects. And human pressure called Ophiophobia, that's what people started, everywhere people started, I am rescuing the snakes. It's not unwarranted, unwanted, that what we record is try to educate the people that we should try to live with this snake. That's called Ophiophobia, should be get rid of this Ophiophobia and try to educate the people. And generally people are saying illegal killing. It's as far as my last 30 years experience, that illegal killing is almost stopped. I do not know whether it's happening in a very remote area, but there is no evidences available about illegal killing. That we should remove that things from threats. Then I was again mentioning no proper inventory. The inventory should be made to all group of organisms. Unfortunate that there is people getting more and giving more priority to elite group of animals, but not these kind of little known animals are ignored all the times. That proper inventory is required. Then lot of research is going on impact of pesticide on mammals and birds and even amphibian, but we do not have any scientific evidences whether these snakes are susceptible for a pesticide effect or not. This should be again studied. These are the major threats what I feel should be considered by our scientific community. Then another thing, very interesting thing is, I didn't put that slide, so this what is its natural predator. But even last 30 years, we used to read a lot of things. Small snakes are being taken away by various birds and mammals and other things being reported. But even I was reading a lot of literature saying that is peacock also one of that predator for snakes. But my 30 years careers have never seen that body called peafowl taking away these snakes. It's very rare. But what's happened about few days back, I noticed even people also say that mongoose also one of the predator for snakes. Actually, last 30 years, I never come across such a situation. But few days back, I myself observed there it's incident happened in my present office at Eco Park, that is one of the mightiest mongoose started fighting with this 6 feet cobra and killed the cobra and tried to drag away this cobra inside the jungle. what biggest disturbance left it. Whether this mongoose can swallow the entire 6 feet cobra or not, we do not know, because that still its subject is open. What are the predators for snakes? Whether it can predate their large snakes or only the small snakes. But I am sure these mongoose or peafowl or other birds can hunt that only small snakes, not like larger than snakes. But it should be examined. This is the latest incident we photographed in Adyar Koga. See, then again I am reiterating that is what is the conservation measures required is nothing but preventing habitat destruction. As far as my knowledge in the last 30 years in the field, we felt this habitat destruction is a major impediment in bringing up the snake population. Even that is urbanization also the major reason for snake habitat is being destroyed. In fact, when I was joined at a snake parasite research scholar in opposite, there was in a Sana University. I used to go for a lunch or a breakfast to the canteen. I used to see sauscaled viper in these premises. Below that, some kind of thorny bushes. Now these bushes are not there. No snakes are reported. Then that is impact of pesticide is not known to snakes, but it should be examined. That's what, whether it's having impact or not, better we should minimize the pesticide use, and controlling illegal trade wherever it happens should be done. Then it almost require large scale awareness about snake is very important. Last 50 years snake power was tirelessly doing this work and bringing awareness and knowledge to community about conservation of snakes. And destruction of snakes will lead to destruction of our food grains. That is a thought of the day, what you call, everybody knows. If there is a rat, there will be snakes. Rat can be controlled exclusively by only two group of organisms, birds, mammals, when it's coming out that outside the burrow. But this only group of organisms, that is snakes, can go into the burrows and hunt the rats. That's why it's play a major role. People, there was some debate is going because that snake's metabolic rate is very less. They may not consume more rats compared with this bonobo or other mammalian group. But this is the only group of animal can go into the rat holes and hunt the rats. That's what it's very interesting and imperative to say that is without snakes, we will destroy our habitat, we'll be losing our food grains. See, I was mentioning what are the simple discipline required for avoiding the snakes. Because entering into the forest area or out fringes of village, finding a snake is not an issue because it's its own habitat. You should not proud of, I mean, encounter and rescue the snakes. But when you are going for a thorough research in the field, you are going to avoid putting your hands inside the cracks, holes, wear shoes that completely cover the feet, always carry the torch and headlamp. That is a simple protection you require. In human habitation, keep houses and other surrounding free of garbages and litters, as this attracts rats, which in turn attract snakes. Walking at night without torch, don't sleep on the ground where snakes are very common. During the study, when you are going for a field inspection, better when handling snakes, use snake hooks or snake grabber. Store live snakes in cloth bags. Avoid keeping venomous snakes or unknown snakes. These are the simple suggestion for field biologists. With a few words, I conclude my suggestion. Don't kill our snakes. Protect our environment. This is the so again, I am requesting all the audience should obey that. Final line, now don't kill snakes, protect our environment. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Ganesh. Thank you, Rajapuram. If you have any doubt,